How many of you are very glad to be here this morning? If you may indulge me, what's your reason?
Fellowship.
That's a good one. Any other reasons?
Why are we together?
Fellowship.
Worship.
Praise. Praise. See, you realize all of these things are all about Jesus, right? Because when we fellowship, he said, where two or three are gathered, that means the smallest church is two people. When you come together, he's right there. You know, when we worship, we are doing it because we adore who he is in our lives. And I don't know about you, but when we close Sunday, my mind instantly goes to next Sunday. So I literally just zone out all week looking forward to Sunday again. And of course, coming from a Seventh-day Adventist background, we always looked for Saturday like we expected Jesus to come back on Saturday. So in a way, you would live anywhere you wanted all week, but you better not misbehave starting Friday evening, because you may be found not ready to go. But it's always a pleasure when saints look forward to this, because fellowship is the heart of Christianity. When Jesus gathered the disciples and when he was leaving them, he told them about this. He told them to continue doing this. And the writer of Hebrew later tells us that forsake not the gathering together like some do. And the miracle is when we gather together, God will take of the spirit that's upon Don and give to Skip. Oh, what's upon Skip and give to Ken. Oh, what's upon him and give to the other person, because we share all things together. Amen? So good morning, brothers and sisters. Today we gather here to reflect on the profound truth found in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 26 through 31. And I decided to call my sermon, God Qualifies the Called. See, by human standards, for you to do anything of repute, to do accounting, to do anything, the first thing they ask you is your resume. The reason they ask for your resume, not to see how well you can write. I mean, it's probably part of the reason, but they want to see what qualifications you have that qualify you to do the job that they want you to do. And half the time, they will just look at it and throw it here, because they're looking for specific qualifications. And if they do not show up on your resume, the first thing they do is put you on the side, because they don't even have to read the rest of it. You do not have the qualifications. But God somehow does things in the reverse. He will call people that by all human standards are totally unqualified. And then he will begin to qualify them on the job. So this is a message of hope and encouragement for all of us, regardless of our backgrounds and abilities and status in society. Through this sermon, we will explore how God's grace and power work in our lives, transforming us, equipping us for this work of the ministry. Now, I don't know about you, but we were all saved for one purpose and one purpose alone. Who knows that purpose? Yes, she got it. We were saved to serve. We were all of us were saved to serve. Ministry is not for the person who just got ordained, or the person that was ordained, or who will be ordained. We have all been called to serve the risen Lord. And some of us don't even realize we are serving God because we do not have a title, but we are all called to serve. Jesus called the disciples a bunch of fishermen, tax collectors. He called this whole group of misfits and said, come and I will qualify you. And the words he used with Peter were, I will make you a fisher of men. I sometimes think about that and I'm thinking, you know, Peter has been a fisherman all his life. All he knows is catching fish and taking care of boats and mending nets and all of that. Now, if Jesus told him, come and I'll make you a preacher, he'd probably say, no, thank you. Because he'd start thinking, what does Peter know about preaching? What can even Peter tell anybody? I'm a fisherman. You see, fishermen, I don't know about fishermen around here, but where I come from, fishermen are not usually exalted people in society. In fact, sometimes when somebody wants to put you down, they'll say, he's just a fisherman. And I don't imagine Peter would have thought of himself as a mighty apostle, sharing the gospel, winning people into the kingdom of heaven. Because he was also a man that came out of the Old Testament, that required you to have certain levels of perfection in order for God to use you. Do you know, according to the law of Moses, even if you had a slight blemish, you know, oh, you could call it a birthmark, but it would disqualify you to serve in the sanctuary. Just a birthmark. You think right, you're strong, but just because you have something, which is rather insignificant, but by law, you cannot serve God. And so people like Peter, people like Paul, well, Paul had some education, was highly qualified in a sense, but he also tells us later that, well, it is a true and faithful saying that Christ came to die for sinners, of whom I am chief. And by the time he calls himself the chief of sinners, he is a powerful apostle. So he's trying to level the ground, level the playing field, and say, look, don't you look at me and think I'm anything special. If anything, I'm probably worse than all of you. If there is anything good in me right now, it is because of Jesus. Amen? So that text of scripture says that God has chosen the foolish and the weak. I want you to think about that. See, when he says that not many of us were qualified by human standards, he probably didn't live in our day and age. On average, everybody at least has a degree or something, or a certificate of something. And yet he's trying to make a point here that for God to use a man, he does not start by looking at your qualifications, because your qualifications, though they may be good tools before God, the way God qualifies you is the only thing that matters for him. We had Dr. Luke, who wrote the book of Acts. And yet, when we read the New Testament, except for the fact that we know that Luke wrote the gospel and then he wrote the book of Acts, we probably do not know so much about Luke at all. And he'd probably not be known to us if it wasn't for the things he did under the power of the Holy Spirit, like writing the book of Luke and writing the book of Acts. So in verse 27, Paul writes, but God chose what is foolish in the world to shame the wise. God chose what is weak in the world to shame the strong. This verse tells us that God's ways are often contrary to the world's standards. You see, when you believe on the Lord Jesus Christ, I do not know, but in most places you are called a fool. You know, to most people, how can a sensible person believe that your sins will only be taken away by believing in some fellow who died 2,000 years ago? It almost sounds foolish. Romans 1:18 says that God chose to bring the gospel to the people through the foolishness of preaching. Because the things we talk about, the things the gospel talks about to the average person, they are foolishness. In fact, in the day and age we're living in today, the world has taken all kinds of turns, unbelievable turns, in the way of being smart. They're doing things that 10, 15 years ago were, nobody would even think those things could be done, but somehow people are too smart, they have invented them. And today they have become mainstream, and if you don't believe them, now you are the fringe. This is the way of the gospel. God takes people that the world looks down on. I mean, go through this whole of heroes of faith in Hebrews 11. It is filled with men and women that are, by our standard, shouldn't be serving God. Think about David. You know, this fellow is called a man after God's own heart, but when we read his story, it's got some real black spots. You know, somehow when you talk about them, even on the pulpit, they would sound obscene by every other standard. You know, he takes a man's wife, and in order to cover up his sin, he kills the man. I mean, who can be so conniving like this guy? And yet somehow God chooses that through him, I'm going to show myself strong in the earth. And not just that, he turns out to be one of the grandparents of our Lord Jesus Christ. Now, if you think God cannot use you, I want you to measure up to David in that sense. So I also want you to consider the example of Gideon. Gideon was a son of a priest of Baal. Did you know that? His father was the one leading Israel to worship idols. Literally, everybody would come to Gideon's home and they would bow to these false idols. And when God comes to choose a man through whom he would deliver Israel, he goes into the house of a priest of Baal and recruits a minister, recruits a judge, and says, through this man, I'm going to show myself strong. In the book of Judges, we are told that when Gideon has had these encounters with the angels, something interesting happens. He goes home. He destroys the grove that people used to bow down to when they're worshiping Baal. You can find this in Judges 6. And he destroys it. And he destroys the altar of Baal. And the following day when people come around, they find the altar has been destroyed. And the first thing they're thinking is, we have to kill him. We have to kill him. How could he destroy our God? Beware if you worship a God that can be destroyed. Because that God is not a God. But my point, Gideon was chosen by God to lead Israel into battle against the Midianites. Filled with doubt and insecurity, Gideon questioned his ability to fulfill such a task. I mean, Gideon was losing here. Even after he accepts the call of God, he gathers as many mighty men throughout Israel as he could find, and God tells him there are too many. I don't know about you, but if I was Gideon, I'd be like, my hands are tied. To begin with, I had nothing. I'm not smart. I'm not this. I'm not that. I'm barely qualified now. I've gathered a bunch of people that I think they got it and they can help me get to wherever you need me to go. And you're telling me there are too many. What do you want me to do? It's exactly what God wants all of us to do, to depend on him. The one promise throughout the Bible is that I am with you. He told that to Moses when Moses had all the excuses of not going back. You know, I killed somebody over there. Everybody has been hunting me. And so far, I have been able to stay off the grid for quite a bit. Now you're sending me back into the lion's den. I know I'm not doing that. And God says, go back. Why? Because I'm going to be with you. Think about that. Think about David. The youngest in his family, least esteemed. In fact, his family did not even regard him to be part of the family because it seemed everybody else had accomplishments except David. Because when Samuel comes to the house, all he gets to see is Aminadab, all his other brothers that were in the military, that were already out in a campaign against the Philistines. And they're the ones that come. And somehow, as they're trying to anoint them, God says, no, these, I haven't chosen any of these. They're good looking, they're tall, they're smart. They have done mighty great things, but they are not the person I want to use. And when Samuel stops and says, is there any other person in the house of Jesse? I imagine it's almost an afterthought that, oh, well, there is my youngest son, but he probably is not the one. He's usually out in the field, you know, taking care of sheep. There is nothing good about him. I mean, he's really crazy, but, oh, well, he also plays music, but that's all there is to him. Not much. And he says none of us is going to sit until he shows up. And so David comes from the field. Everybody else had opportunity to clean up and wash off and get ready for the ceremony. When David came from the field, before he even cleaned up and looked good for the ceremony, the Bible says Samuel had him get down and pour the oil over this young man's head and says, look, here is the king of Israel, a man after God's own heart. Now, when I read this story, it confuses me. All the things in the Old Testament, if you're going to go before God, there was ceremonial cleansing. You had to go through this. You had to worship. You had to put on the right robe. You had to have your hair look exactly a certain way. You had to be all of these things. But when God chose David, he didn't have to go through all of that stuff. That tells me that when God calls you, your answer should not be, look, I do not have this. I do not know this. I didn't do this. I can't do that. I can't do this. Your answer should be, here I am. Send me. Because if he sends you and you mess things up, that's not on you. That's on him. You should never have an excuse for serving God. Because the God that called you, he called you because he knew he was able to turn you into the person he has called you to be. When he called David and told him he was the king of Israel, there were a couple of years before David became everything God called him to be. And if God had showed him the journey, how it would look like, he'd probably never have accepted. But he accepted knowing the faithfulness of God. Amen? So God qualifies you after he calls you. Moses, having lived in the palace, didn't know anything about ministry. He hadn't even lived enough among the children of Israel to know what God was all about. So he's out hiding in the hills and he's rearing sheep. He's basically doing a very low man's job. See, where I come from, if you're living at your in-law's house, everybody looks down on you. Because a man, you got to rise up and get your own home and marry a wife in your own home. But Moses was living at his in-law's home and he was taking care of the sheep that belonged to his in-laws. Literally, he wasn't bringing much to the plate. He was taking so much from the plate. And yet when God comes to look for a minister, he doesn't go for his elder brother Aaron
who probably understood a lot about God in comparison to Moses, he looked for Moses, who knew absolutely nothing about God. God loves empty vessels. He loves empty vessels. He loves unqualified people. He does. He loves the nobodies. Continuing in verse 28, we read, God chose what is low and despised in the world, even things that are not, to bring to nothing things that are. Wow. God has a habit of considering people that everybody regards as nobodies. People the world has given up on. And he chooses those. So, when Jesus is leaving, he says something to the disciples. He says, I need you to stay in Jerusalem. Why? To wait for the promise of the Holy Spirit. And when he has come upon you, then you will be able to go out and be my witnesses. Now, usually, they had seen Jesus resurrected. They believed he was alive. They believed he was the Messiah. They believed he was the soon coming king. So didn't that qualify them to be able to take the gospel to the nations? It should qualify them. They have the information. They know who Jesus is. They have walked with him. They have done things with him. They know him. So they're just going to go out and tell people, this is Jesus. We know him. We walked with him for 3.5 years. Let me tell you about this time when he healed a kid. Oh, let me tell you this time when he fed 5,000. I was there. Literally. I carried the basket and I was serving people. I know the story. But Jesus says, that does not qualify you. I qualify you. So I need you to wait until the qualification comes upon you. Then you will go out. And that qualification was just the Holy Spirit. The Spirit had to come upon them so that the Spirit would lead the things they said and the things they did. With God, having the information alone is not enough. God has to work in and through you to glorify his name. The disciples had the information, but they didn't have the qualification. And then we got in other situations where people didn't have any qualifications, but when the Spirit was upon them, they were qualified. John the Baptist was one of those people. He was born to prepare the way for our Lord. But the only way he knew things the Pharisees didn't know, the teachers of the law, was because of the Spirit of God. We should desire the Holy Spirit of God. Because I do not know about you, but Christianity is so hard if you do not have the Spirit of God working in and through you. God saw something in man that the world had rejected. God still sees something in man that the world has rejected. God sees something in you. He sees something in me that I don't even know about. God sees something in that homeless man on the street side that you don't even know about. God sees something in that drunkard that you pass by and say, man, this fellow is totally hopeless. Don't be surprised if he's the next day's evangelist. Because God takes things that the world regards to be nothing. And the only thing these things have is God working in and through them. God has called us because only he can qualify us. God has given us a job, but only he can work through us to fulfill that job. There is a verse I love so much. It's in Philippians 2:13. It says, for it is God who works in us both to will and to do for his good pleasure. Think about that every time you have an excuse not to serve God. And then the Bible talks about no boasting. We can't boast. If Jesus found me on the streets, drugged out, and he picked me from there and did a work in me, and now I'm able to stand in front of people. How can I brag about that? How can I brag that I did something good for God? I can't. Because anything I'm able to do now for the Lord is not because I'm smart. It's not because I'm special, because I come from a good family, or because I come from a certain special place. It is because of Christ in me, the hope of glory. Amen? Anything we are able to do now is because of Christ. Let us always remember, when we are called to do something for God, that it is God that is going to make us able to do the things he wants us to do. Let us forget the excuses. The Bible says he chooses the nobodies. He chooses the foolish things of this world. The things that nobody thinks mean anything. And God takes those things and works himself a work in the earth. He did not go to the Pharisees, who are well versed with the Bible. He went to the fishermen. He went to the tax collectors. He found some dude seated under a tree in the middle of the day. People are supposed to be working. He's seated under a tree. And Jesus says, come on. See, Jesus, you should follow some criteria here when you are choosing people. You don't get a fool like that. You get somebody who is smart, who has the smarts. But Jesus doesn't do that. He looks at the Pharisees and he tells them, your problem is you think you're fine. You think you know. You think your eyes are open. That is your problem. If you were blind, then you would have no fault. If you believed you didn't qualify, then you would have no fault. But because you think you are too good, you are too qualified, you are too these things, that is your guilt. You know why most people are not accepting the Lord Jesus Christ in this day and age? It's because most people think they are too smart for God. They can't stand in the same ranks with uneducated people to serve God. They can't do that. I mean, I'm a doctor of something. Why should I hang with all you people that don't have any doctorate? No, we can't be on the same level. Can't happen. All of that to say, let us remember that the God that called us is faithful to accomplish what he has called us to accomplish through us. Amen? So he has become our wisdom, our righteousness, and our redemption. So, in conclusion, as we reflect on this passage, let us be encouraged. God does not call the qualified, rather he qualifies the called. Throughout history, he has chosen the unlikely, the weak, and the despised to accomplish his purposes. He does not require us to be perfect or to have all the answers. Instead, he asks for our willingness, faith, and surrender. Who is going to surrender today to the work of God? Who is going to surrender today to the call of God? Why would anybody not surrender to a God that is going to qualify you? And all you need to say is, here I am. I'm asking you today to surrender yourself to the will of God. When you go to prayer this evening, tell God that I'm available to work any way you choose to have me work. I do not even know how you'd use me, but I'm here. If you need an idiot to use, I'm right here. Let him know. Because he's got a job for you. You just don't know it yet. You're not too old. Abraham was 90-something. 70-something, then 90-something. You know, Moses started his ministry at 80 years old. So you all need to go tell God you are ready to do whatever he needs you to do. Because he will equip you for whatever he has called you for. May we never boast in our own abilities, but boast only in the Lord, who qualifies and empowers us to do his will. Let us embrace his wisdom, righteousness, and redemption as we walk in obedience to his call. Remember, it's not about who we are, but who he is. May the Lord bless his word. May you go forth in that knowledge. And may he use it to raise you up to be the giants that I know you are. In Jesus' name.